please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Halftime Report. I'm Sumaira Abdi and with me is my colleague Nigel D'Souza. And for now, Nigel, it looks like, we're near the low point of the day. So just about holding on to that 10,500 level on the Nifty. The Sensex is down about 130-odd points. The mid-cap index, it's down about 1% now, and that too at the low point of the day. And I guess it must be pretty much everything, you know, even the Nifty Bank, if you pull it up, you'll see that it's just barely at the lows of trade.
That's right. You know, Sumaira, we've been talking about this entire global market rally that we've seen. Well, we've not been part of it. At the start of today, we were up close to 0.5%. Now we've virtually given even that up. So for the week itself, we're more or less flattish. And that's a stark underperformance. If you take a look at what's going on with the US markets, they are between 5 to around 7%. The European markets are higher. The emerging markets like Brazil and Russia, they are higher with a gain of around 4 to around 6%. So we, in fact, a stark underperformance. And as we speak, we're gradually moving to the low point of the day. The bulls will be hoping we go ahead and we defend yesterday's low. At least we hold on to that 10,500-odd mark on a closing basis. So that's going to be quite important. Can we have a recovery in the second half of trade? That's going to be the crucial factor. Otherwise, in fact, it's not looking too good. Remember, the next technical support level is at around that 10,380-odd mark. So we'll keep an eye out on that front, currently flirting with the 10,500 level. But we'll talk more about levels. We'll get in a couple of managements, and we'll highlight a whole host of stocks. First up, running you through all the top stories at this point of time.
All right, those are all the top stories. It's time now for Movers and Shakers. So let's tell you about all the stocks which are on investors' radars this afternoon. And top of mind, once again, is PNB. So Ritu Singh is here with the very latest. Ritu.
Well, Sumaira, it's the third day since the scam was disclosed. And the big action that has happened in the last 3 days is in terms of the raids that have started to happen on all the culprits that were named in the FIR. The CBI and the ED both, remember, are acting on the first set of FIR filed, which was relating to the 280 crore scam. And what ED, you know, this morning has sent a statement saying they have seized diamonds, jewelry, and gold, which they claim is worth 5,100 crore rupees during these searches. And six properties in Bombay that belong to Nirav Modi have also been sealed. In the meantime, you know, Network 18 reporters say, you know, reports say that Mr. Nirav Modi has been traced to New York, where he's supposed to have been since earlier in January, before the FIR was filed. No connection whatsoever, whether, you know, he was in know of the scam being unearthed whatsoever. But PNB also, you know, made additionally few statements to the exchanges last evening, very late in the night, saying RBI was informed of the fraud for the first time on 29th January when it came to the Nirav Modi Group companies. And for the Gitanjali Group companies, when the loans matured, RBI was subsequently informed and a fraud report was submitted to them on the 7th of February. So a huge lag between the two. PNB also said that 10 officers in total so far have been suspended for their involvement in the fraud or suspected involvement in the fraud, and their liability, that is PNB's, you know, repayment of all of these 11,300 odd crore rupees to the banks that have extended credit against the guarantee issued by PNB, that PNB says will be decided on the basis of the law of the land, which essentially is indicating on what RBI has to say in the matter. Of course, sources do indicate that informally RBI has communicated to PNB to honor all the dues, and that is exactly what the management also said yesterday when they addressed the media, that they will, they haven't received any formal direction from RBI in the matter, but will take full responsibility if investigations place the onus on PNB.
Okay, all right, Ritu, we'll keep coming to you all through today as we've been doing over the last few days to get the latest of what's going on there. But for the time being, let's go across to Sonal. Remember, Jet Airways was under some pressure post their results. And Sonal, she was a busy girl yesterday listening into the con call. Sonal, tell us.
Well, in the morning, the stock opened up in green because the management reiterated their guidance on the cost reduction plans. But I think now the street is focusing on the fact that the yields have been under pressure both in the domestic and international markets. So if I take you through the major takeaways, well, the traffic growth and the passenger growth was at historical highs for Jet Airways. And also, they've been able able to reduce their costs this quarter by 2.6%, and they have reiterated that within next 18 to 24 months, they will be able to cut down their costs by 15 to 20%. But the stock is not really buzzing in trade and not liking the fact that the Gulf market, that remains depressed, and there is mild recovery in that market, but still in Q4, they do not expect it to recover fully. Apart from that, the yields are continuously under pressure, even in the domestic markets. However, the management was very positive. They said that they will be able to cut down their costs, and they are on that path of cost reduction measures, and that's why the stock is in red right now.
All right, Sonal, thanks very much for that. Now on to the Daiichi Fortis case. In the very latest, the apex court has struck down the Singh brothers' plea, which had challenged the Delhi High Court order upholding the award. So another setback coming their way. Ashmit is the very latest on this. Ashmit, go ahead.
Well, this is indeed a big setback as far as Singh brothers are concerned. This marks the exhaustion of all their legal remedies that they had in India against that arbitral award of 3,500 crore rupees. What this effectively means is that they've exhausted the last legal remedy they had, which is an appeal before the Supreme Court, and now they will have to cough up that amount, at least as of now. That is how things stand. The Supreme Court had heard their challenge to the Delhi High Court order. The Delhi High Court order had upheld the arbitral award. Singh Brothers had moved the apex court and had challenged that, and they had challenged it here. The hearing was very brief. Justice Gogoi, however, made it abundantly clear, making it unequivocal, that he sees no glaring error as a part of this appeal. He sees absolutely no error in that order, that he feels no reason to grant any relief or any leave to the Singh brothers. So as of now, they've exhausted their Indian legal remedies. But what's important to keep in mind is that this arbitral award was granted by a Singapore arbitration tribunal. In appeal against that, the Singh brothers have already moved the Singapore Court of Appeals. So that is where the focus will now shift. That is where the attention will now shift. That is the one legal remedy available to them where they're likely to go ahead and challenge this arbitral award of 3,500 crore rupees. But as things stand right now in India, the status quo has been declared by the Supreme Court. They will have to cough up that amount, subject to, of course, appeal before the Singapore Court of Appeals.
All right. Thanks so much, Ashmit, for joining in and giving us those details. We're moving on then from the sidelines of the ENY Entrepreneur of the Year Awards. Priya Seth caught up with Dilip Sanghvi of Sun Pharma and began by asking him his outlook on the pharma industry and also asked him his view on the rising pricing pressures. Let's hear him out.
Pricing pressure continues to be there in the market, and we expect this to continue to stay for some more time.
So when do you think this would possibly, when would we be out of this kind of pricing pressure? When do you think the market will stabilize going forward?
No, my view is that pricing is always product specific. And depending on when you reach a equilibrium on price, prices will stabilize. We are seeing that some product prices are gradually going up also.
What would you say would be the three major challenges that the industry is facing at this point in time as we look ahead in 2018?
The industry has a challenge in terms of pricing, in terms of increasing competition and potentially depleting patent expiry pipeline.
So one big news that's changed the global scene at this point in time is that Warren Buffett has bought in some stock in Teva as we speak. How do you view this development?
No, I mean, I think clearly it's a great benefit for the industry because he thinks that industry has reached a level where he sees a significant upside for his investment. And I think we will see that many other investors potentially follow him back into the sector.
So do you pose, how would you look at this as a competitor?
No, I think ultimately everybody tries and invests in the best company in the sector. So it encourages us to try and be the best company in the sector so that we are within the investment horizon of majority of the global investors.
Recovery from the Nifty from the low point of the day. So that's good news, actually. You know, a couple of stocks fighting in there. I think HDFC, that should be one stock that's trying to hold, the Nifty. And I think a couple of other stocks, something like a Sun Pharma as well, has recovered from the low point of the day. HDFC Bank is the one I'm talking about. So I think we should get that one up. It's more or less flattish, but it's seen a bit of an uptick. Sun Pharma as well is fighting for the bulls. And I think even L&T, that one as well. And that's why we're seeing a quick 15-point pullback from the day's low. But let's talk about the broader markets. TD Power, that's a stock that's in focus. Remember, they came out with their numbers. Well, it was a decent set of numbers, more or less a flattish set. It's coming on a low base as well. The big question is, what's the outlook for FY19? To understand that and more, we have Mr. Nikhil Kumar, the MD of the company, who joins in. Hi, Mr. Kumar. Thanks so much, sir, for joining in. Well, if you could help us out with, for the first 9 months, what has been the order intake? And are there more orders in the pipeline that your investors can look forward to, sir?
So let me just focus on the manufacturing business, because that's where we are, that's where our future is. I'm not going to talk very much about the EPC on projects business, because the EPC business has been shut down. So in the manufacturing business, our order inflow for the first 9 months has been flat. So it's about 261 crores this year versus 259 crores last year. Not including the large order that we got from a major multinational company for the railway business, which is 750 crores, which was taken in this financial year. So if you add that, we have really got a big order inflow, but that will not show in the books in terms of our manufacturing until FY21. But looking at the outlook, to answer your question, looking at the outlook for Q4 in terms of order inflow, which will completely influence our revenues for FY19, I have indicated earlier that we are going to have an extremely strong order inflow in Q4, mainly driven by exports, mainly driven by exports, especially in the steam turbine business, hydro business, and the gas engine business. And I've also said there's going to be some incremental business coming out of wind. So we will see a very, very healthy, large order inflow coming in Q4, which will drive our growth into FY19.
That's a large order inflow. You're saying you've done 260 crores in terms of an order inflow. What can it be 100 crores? Can it be 50 crores? What kind of a number are we looking at? Because the 290, actually, if I just divide it by 3, it comes to roughly around 85 crores approximately. So are we looking at a number better than that?
Yeah, much, much, much better than that. So if you look at last year, we did about 95 crores in Q4 order inflow.
Okay.
We're definitely going to be way above that number in Q4 this year.
Okay.
Hi, Mr. Kumar. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
So are you suggesting that, recovery in your top line will only be seen FY20-21 onwards?
No, there'll be a recovery in the top line in FY19. And that's why I'm, upbeat about, and I'm not just upbeat, I'm also seeing the numbers coming in January and February for the order inflow for Q4. So I'm seeing a large order inflow in Q4, which will drive revenues in FY19. Okay. So we will see a recovery in our basic business without the railway business in FY19, and then once the railway business starts in FY, part of it will start in FY20, but the major volumes will start from FY21. Mm. We'll see an additional incremental top up, so to speak, in terms of revenues from that business.
Could you give us a sense of what the ballpark numbers could look like for FY19 and FY20?
I have committed to give the market numbers during the next earnings call, and I will do that in the next earnings call. I have indicated to the market that we are in a very good position to show good numbers, and I'm pretty sure about things happening because we're already coming to the end of Feb and a lot of water already is thrown under the bridge. We have our numbers already, but I can't declare to the market right now.
All right. Mr. Kumar, give us a sense. What is your current capacity utilization levels? And for next year, how do you see that move higher? Going by your commentary, FY20 and 21, we'll really see a big bump up because of that big order that you've won. But currently, what, you're at 55%?
We're at 55% capacity utilization, Nigel. And I can't give you a capacity utilization outlook for next year because that's, you can calculate the back.
Yeah, we were trying to do it the other way around.
Yeah. So hang on for a couple of weeks. We'll give you all the projections very shortly. Right now, I'm giving a positive outlook for the business.
All right. Mr. Kumar, if you could tell us, final question from my end before we let you go. Your margins, they were at sub 5%. Why is that? Going ahead, should we be working with this sort of a margin, 3 to 5%? Or can we do what you should normally do, 7-8%?
There are two driving factors. One is that the domestic market is still quite brutal, so there's a lot of pricing pressure. There's a lot of pricing pressure in the domestic market. The second is that since we have a large export base, and this year, this financial year particularly, we've not had a very strong euro, especially up to, let's say, especially Q1, Q2, and we started seeing some recovery or some appreciation of the euro towards Q3.
Okay.
And now in Q4, we're seeing, so like, for example, through the euro is like close to 80 rupees, which will dramatically change our margin profile. So if you look at the average euro realization in the past 9 months, it's been something like 72 or 73 for the company. And even now with the euro at 80, there's a dramatic 10% realization increase that we're going to see just on the exchange rate.
Okay.
So we are going to see margins moving forward changing, and our margins are definitely influenced by the exchange rate.
Okay.
Okay. And Mr. Kumar, we leave it at that. Thanks very much for joining in. So that's quite an optimistic note, actually, coming in from the management, although we wish there were more details. But Mr. Kumar promises that with Q4 numbers, there would be that he would cement the details in terms of outlook for FY19 and 20. Meanwhile, Gitanjali Gems already locked in a 20% lower circuit. Further news coming that the finance ministry officials say that a probe on 36 firms linked with Gitanjali Gems will be launched soon post the PNB fraud case. And also the Enforcement Directorate has issued summons to Nirav Modi and I think also Mehul Choksi under the PMLA Act. So I suppose the noose seems to be tightening, and what I do pick up is that maybe that they have to depose before the ED in a week's time.